Secretary Castro, thank you so much for joining us.
Good to be with you.
So early on in this debate, you had a moment with Vice President Biden that so many Democrats are talking about, social media is talking about. We want to roll that clip right now.
Are you forgetting what you said 2 minutes ago? Are you forgetting already what you said just 2 minutes ago? I mean, I can't believe that you said 2 minutes ago that they had to buy in, and now you're saying they don't have to buy. You're forgetting that.
I said anyone your grandmother who has no money.
We need a healthcare system
that automatically
enrolls people regardless of whether they choose to opt in or not. If you lose your job, for instance, his healthcare plan would not automatically enroll you. You would have to opt in. My healthcare plan would. That's a big difference. I'm fulfilling the legacy of Barack Obama, and you're not.
I'll be surprised to him.
Now, Secretary Castro, we reviewed the transcript, but before I tell you what we found in the transcript, do you regret that?
No, we were having a debate about healthcare policy, and last time we were on stage in Detroit, Senator Harris said that Vice President Biden's plan leaves 10 million people uncovered. Vice President Biden at the time said that wasn't the case. Fact checkers went back and they said, yeah, actually it is the case that his plan does leave 10 million people uncovered. I heard him describe his plan, and he said, as I looked at the transcript, that
Checked the transcript as well.
Of course I did. And this is an argument about healthcare policy. So this is important, right? We're talking about a policy that is going to impact every single person in this country. So what he said in the transcript was that if you lose your job, that you could automatically buy in to his plan. You need to catch the distinction here.
Right.
When he says you can automatically buy in, there is no automatic about it, because people aren't all going to be able to buy in. The difference is, in my plan and some of the other plans that have been laid out, you don't have to buy in. You automatically would be enrolled. That's the distinction here. So I know that some have suggested...
Right.
It's the difference between him saying that you could, if you lose your job, you could automatically buy in. That means if you have to buy something, you have to affirmatively do something, right? That means that 10 million people are going to be left uncovered. In my plan, you wouldn't have to buy in. You would automatically be put in that plan without buying in. That's an important distinction. This is not about personalities. It's not about individuals. This is about healthcare policy.
But I think part of the problem was, maybe it's not even about policy. The problem, I think, for some Democrats, from what we're hearing, what we're reading, is that it was the tone. It was almost like you were taking a shot at his age. Was that fair? Was that necessary?
I wasn't taking a shot at his age. I was taking a shot at the fact that he had just said the words buy in. You would have to buy in. So I said, look, you just said that you would have to buy in. He said, no, I didn't. I said, did you forget that you just said that you would have to buy in?
Right. So, did you just forget what you said 2 seconds ago?
Yeah, so what I'm saying is that when you look at the transcript and you understand the healthcare policy and the meaning of that, the significance of that, the difference is that 10 million people would get left out under his plan. That's why that's so important. It's not an attack on Vice President Biden. It's not something about the personalities. It's about the healthcare policy. That was my focus.
You clearly were trying to draw a difference, though, with Vice President Biden throughout this debate. Do you think you can peel voters off his support and sort of uplift your campaign? Was that one of your strategies?
No. Look, I was the first candidate to put out an immigration plan. I was the first candidate to put out a police reform plan. I was the first candidate to call for President Trump's impeachment. I went to San Juan, Puerto Rico, instead of Des Moines or Manchester first in this campaign. I have been leading the way on many issues in this campaign without respect to any one person on the stage or what other candidates are doing. I think people are coming my way because I'm leading, not following.
When you had that moment with Vice President Biden, Mayor Pete had said something about sort of, this is the worst thing about politics. That's not an exact quote, but that was the tone. And you said it's the primaries. It sort of, we need to do this.
Yeah, hey, look, this is what I hear when I go out there, whether it's to Iowa or New Hampshire or anywhere else. What I hear is people are concerned that we need to beat Donald Trump. And they also want to know that when you get on that debate stage in October of 2020, that you're going to be able to take on Donald Trump. All right? And so I think what they've been able to see, that in a respectful but tough way, I can take on Donald Trump in October of 2020, and I can do it effectively. I think people saw that again tonight.
Did you speak to Vice President Biden after the debate?
Yeah, we just said hello during the breaks. I know Vice President Biden. I have tremendous respect for him. You know, I think he's a great candidate. You know, he's been in public service and in politics a long time, like many of the candidates there. This is the nature of debate. This is about the policy. It wasn't about the personalities.
Julian Castro explaining that moment that so many will be talking about for the days ahead.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.